with all the noise around the carbon legislation at the moment, will you actually get it through by the end of the year?
Oh, well, that's the objective, that's for sure, and we're very determined to achieve it. And, of course, we've spent months and months doing policy development work and negotiating it within the multi-party climate change committee. And, of course, one of the purposes of that was to gain the necessary support in the House of Representatives and the Senate to get the legislation through. We've achieved that support. We've announced the policy. We intend getting the legislation through before the end of the year.
There is a definite campaign by the opposition to derail the government before July 1, using whatever tactics they can to prevent this coming in. They're now working on a 7-8 month timetable. What are the dangers for you in that time between getting the legislation through and getting it enacted?
Well, look, we don't judge our own processes by what Tony Abbott's doing. Tony Abbott's, you know, behaving in the most extraordinary fashion, whipping up fear where it's not justified, spreading concern, talking down the economy, damaging consumer sentiment, all for what? His own political purposes. I mean, the government has a program here. We're determined to get on with our program. We're making very important reforms. The NBN putting a price on carbon, which will drive change in the economy in a very productive way in the years to come. We've got health reforms. We've done a lot in the education area. We're going to get on with what people expect of a government, and we're not going to be deterred by Tony Abbott's carry-on.
He's promised, though, a rollback of this, as you know. Will it be difficult to roll it back after July 1?
Well, this is all politics. You know, let's just consider it rationally for a moment. What's he proposing to roll back and when? That means he's going to have to cut pensions because the government's increasing them. It means he's going to put up tax because the government's cutting tax. He's going to have to create a lot of uncertainty for business in relation to property rights that companies would hold in the form of carbon permits. It is a complex reform. It is one that the economy needs. It's one that people in the business community broadly recognise is necessary. We have international obligations that ultimately we'll be entering into that mean we do need to cut pollution further in our economy. These are the important parameters for this. And at the end of the day, this is good for the economy. It'll drive investment and innovation in clean energy sources. It's the right reform to make. So we shouldn't get too distracted by, you know, Tony Abbott's articulation of his short-term political objectives.
Do you think this is one of the most divisive debates we've seen in this country?
Well, Tony Abbott has made this divisive. I mean, he's worked with shock jocks. He's relied upon Alan Jones and others to help promote all of this fear and apprehension that's completely unfounded. But let's just come back again and look at some of the facts. The cost of living impact of a reform of this nature is in fact quite modest. It's a 0.7% increase in the CPI, less than $10 a week averaged across all Australian households, and the government's providing tax cuts and increases in the pension and other benefits that average in benefit across Australian households of slightly more than $10 a week. You know, the whole hype that Tony Abbott has created about, in his terms, unimaginable, you know, cost impacts, of course, is completely deceitful and untrue. The concern he's generated about job security is also completely unfounded and untrue. He has said that the entire coal industry will be destroyed. That's what he said. He's forecast that entire towns and regions are going to be wiped off the map, that the manufacturing industry will die. I mean, this is the most absurd, hyperventilating tripe that I can remember in public life. And we have to keep that in perspective. This is Tony Abbott and others in the community creating all of this really quite absurd concern about something that is a productive economic reform for us to make, and the government will not be distracted by it. And of course, as the carbon price legislation comes in, we start the task of cutting our pollution, driving investment in clean energy sources. People with the lived experience of this change, well, I think, will start to scratch their heads about Tony Abbott's performance.
Well, indeed, the Coal Association has been very strong on arguing against the carbon tax and supporting the advertising campaigns against the carbon tax. On the basis of their studies, they say there'll be 3,000 jobs lost in the industry, and that did make front page headlines around the country. Are they wrong?
The Coal Association's commentary during this debate has no credibility whatsoever, as far as I'm concerned. Claims of massive job losses are completely absurd. The coal industry has at least $70 billion worth of investment coming into it that's committed, 19 new mines opening up that are committed, and it will, I think, commence production before the end of 2014. A further 68 mines are projected to open up. Coal output is going to grow significantly, I think probably by 45 or 50% to the year 2020. That's massive over the next 8 years. Where's the job losses coming from again? I mean, the jobs in the coal industry are going to grow. The industry has a very strong future. You know, the average carbon price cost per tonne of coal mined once the carbon price legislation comes into place is only $1.90 per tonne of coal in the first year. $1.90 as against a coke and coal export price currently in excess of $300 a tonne. I mean, it's a modest impost on the industry, and it will create an incentive to reduce their methane emissions, and that's a positive thing.
Well, if the industry associations are saying this, aren't they backed by the individual CEOs from BHP and Rio and the other companies?
Well, sometimes you see these peak bodies, of course, running a position out, but you don't see much advocacy from individual members. And to be fair, we really haven't seen much commentary from BHP Billiton nor Rio Tinto, and they understand the carbon price legislation well. I deal with those companies. In fact, Marius Kloppers very early in this term of government called for a carbon tax to be implemented. I mean, they know these things are coming. They operate in the international environment and they deal with them internationally. And what's more, they've been making their investment decisions for years in industries like the coal industry on an assumption that a carbon price will be coming in. What we're seeing is a few spokespeople from within the coal industry carrying on in this way, but they really should just focus on their businesses, I think.
And what's their motive? Just to leverage a bit more assistance?
Well, I'll just ask you this, I suppose. Is it surprising that the coal industry, you know, some players, I should say, in the coal industry mightn't like the idea of a carbon price at the end of the day? I think people understand what's going on there.
If carbon pricing was Labor policy, why didn't you take it to the last election?
Well, there's a fair history to this, and I think you could go back to 2005, where Labor first articulated a climate change policy which included a commitment to putting a price on carbon pollution, but we certainly took a very clear policy to the 2007 election, and just long-standing issues. We tried to legislate it, was defeated three times in the Parliament, by the Greens combining with Tony Abbott as the new opposition leader at the time. But remember, John Howard took an emissions trading scheme to the 2007 election as well. The 2010 election, we had a climate change policy which included carbon pricing as well. And on this occasion, we've put forward a comprehensive policy package that is Labor policy. And I think it's clear that Labor has been committed to dealing with climate change for a long period of time. It's not the tail wagging the dog with this policy, you know, the Greens dictating to the government, as some are alleging. This is Labor policy. And you just look at what the Greens opposed in the last term of Parliament. They opposed our starting price, essentially, for the carbon price. They opposed the assistance to industry. They opposed the assistance that's provided to ensure energy security, and particularly to brown coal generators. They've completely backflipped on those things on this occasion and now agreed with the government's position. This is a Labor policy that we've put forward, and it shouldn't be surprising to anyone.
How do you respond to one of the key arguments in the advertising campaign against it, and indeed in many people's eyes, that what Australia does will make very little difference to having an impact on climate change or keeping the temperature at 2 degrees?
Well, you know, we're not on our own here. We're part of an international community. We're the highest polluter per person amongst all the developed economies. We're 1.5% of global pollution. And people seem to seize on that to say, well, that means we shouldn't do anything. Well, there are a lot of other countries. The United Kingdom's around 1.5%, I think, last time I was looking at the numbers. And there's quite a lot of countries in that category of a few percent of global pollution. But they all add up to around 40% countries in that kind of category that we are. If we turn around and say, as the highest polluter per person, oh, it's nothing to do with us, get lost, we're doing nothing, we're safe down here in Australia. What credibility is that going to have? We need international cooperation. Australia's got a proud history of working internationally to achieve, progressive outcomes. This is an occasion where we should be standing tall and playing a responsible and fair role internationally and not burying our heads in the sand. The scientific evidence is clear that we need to tackle climate change. It takes an international effort to achieve it. Australia's got a responsibility to play its part.
Will Julia Gillard be the third political leader that loses her job over carbon pricing?
Obviously, I work closely with the Prime Minister and I've also known her for many years. She's a very gutsy person. She knows that this is the right thing to do and the government's very sincere about that. We believe if you're going to act in the national interest and look ahead, not just to tomorrow's tabloid news headlines or something, but look ahead year after year into the interests of future generations and what it is that's going to make sure that our economy is competitive and successful and that our living standards continue to grow and jobs continue to grow in our own economy, then you have to take hard decisions and make hard reforms. And that's what the Prime Minister's committed to. And I think people will see that she's got the guts to see this through because we are going to see it through.
But several of your own backbenchers have said to me bluntly that if the Prime Minister can not lift your primary vote out of the 20s by the time this reform goes through, that it is virtually impossible for her to stay as Labor Party leader.
Well, I don't agree with that. And are they going public? You know, lots of people say stuff. Oftentimes they don't put their name to it. But what we are doing here is a very important thing for the future of our country, and we're very committed to it. And I think the Prime Minister deserves a lot of credit for that sort of courage because we intend to see this important reform through.